I've been roaming around the state the past few years. I've had a nickname, Dr. Doom. What I hope to do with you today is let's give you a more optimistic outlook on the crop markets. But, you know, as Tom mentioned, he gave me those three questions to deal with. Where have we been? Where are we now? Where are we going? While this is firing up, I'll tell you where we've been, and as soon as the numbers fire up here, we'll see where we've been. But the idea is when we look at the agricultural markets, I'm going to argue it doesn't matter what market you're looking at right now. The problem we've been having is, if you will, we've had record demand, but we've also had record supply for the last 3 to 4 years. As that demand has ratcheted up there, though, the problem is that supplies have overwhelmed that demand. Tom referred back to the prices we had a few years ago. And when you look back at, you know, back in 2012, 2013, and oh, it's starting to fire up now. The idea is we were looking at significantly higher prices. In fact, let me take you to where the corn market is right now. And as you're looking at this table, bottom line down there's price. 2013, we were coming off of what had been the drought of 2012 and the best prices we had ever seen. $7 to $8 corn. Beans well into the teens. Well, since then, I want you to look at line three on this table, production. As you look at production there, 2013, 2014, 2015, 2016, what you were seeing are the four biggest corn crops this country has ever produced. Incredible production there. Now, this gray box down here represents demand, and you look at that total use for those same lines, you're looking at the four best demand years we ever had. So it wasn't a problem of people not wanting the products were being growing. No, demand has never been better. What has been the issue is that those production, that supply, has been running just ahead of that demand. And when you got supplies bigger than demand, you get lower prices. That's what we've experienced the last 4 years. Now, what we hope is changing as we look out there right now, well, in this case, what you're seeing here for 2017, that's USDA's first guess as to what we'll do this spring and how producers or how consumers will react throughout 2017. And I want you to look at that production and total uses line again. What they have is production coming down a bit here, basically because acreage comes down in, yields come back down to more trend line. They have demand also falling off a bit, but in this case, demand stays above supply. And if we can get that, you get better prices. And in fact, I'm going to argue you're already seeing some of that when you look at the markets today. You got a big decision coming up here. Actually, I think it's today, isn't it? Crop insurance deadline. Think back what your crop insurance prices were last year. What did we have for corn and beans? Anybody remember? $3.86 for corn, $8.85 for beans. What are you staring at this year? $10.19 on the beans, so $1.40 higher there. $3.96 on the corn, a dime higher there. Why are we seeing those higher prices in the crop insurance? Well, they're based off the market. So we're already seeing higher prices today than we were a year ago because we've got great demand and the thought that supplies will slow down a little bit. As you look at this demand, I'm going to ask you to key on one line here, and that's going to be the export line, this next to last line here. Because another thing that's true no matter what ag market you're looking at is that when you're looking at U.S. agriculture, we always produce more than we need. We depend upon the rest of the world to buy our excess product. As you look here at corn, we'll export 12 to 15% of the entire crop. As you look at soybeans, I want you to look at that export line again. How much of this crop do we export to other countries? Half. The idea is the international marketplace is where we go when we are long on crop. And are we long on crop right now? Yeah, we've definitely got a lot of crop to work with here. And so trade is going to be a big deal for us. If we're looking for higher prices in 17, it comes on the back of that international market. And right now, what I'm going to point out is that international marketplace, as you look here, has been growing year after year after year. In fact, on the soybean side, I'm looking at record exports right now. And the hope is that continues. And so we're going to talk a lot about trade today. Because let's face it, if there's one area of demand that right now has a storm cloud on the horizon, it is trade. But right now, that trade is crucial. Again, if we want to keep the prices, the higher prices that we're experiencing, and hopefully build on them, we're going to depend upon that trade. Because when you look at supplies worldwide, I'm going to argue the issue is similar to what we're seeing here in the U.S. We've got massive supplies around the world. As you look here at the 2015 and 2016 corn crops, those are the two biggest corn crops the world has ever seen. We weren't the only ones creating more supply. In fact, as you look at this far right-hand column, that's the change over this past year for each of those countries. Notice there aren't too many negative numbers there. Everybody has been growing more corn and soybeans. Why? Because those have been the best crops to create some economic opportunities. And as you look at this chart, though, there are a couple of negative numbers up there. Who do they belong to? China? Canada? Those are two big negative numbers to me. Why? Those are our two biggest agricultural trading partners. Each of those countries is worth about $20 billion to us in agriculture. With China, it's mostly soybeans. Roughly about half that, about $10 billion of that value is in soybeans alone. With Canada, it's all sorts of products. And the idea is those are the only two places that we see when we look around the world that grew less corn. What should that mean for us as we look forward in the export markets? This is opening up opportunities for us. That our two biggest trading partners, they're the ones growing less, so we'll be able, hopefully, to sell more. And we want to keep that up. Now, China's one I'm going to watch very closely here. As you can see here, they're that next to bottom line here. And China does produce a lot of corn. In fact, they're the second largest producer of corn in the world. But what they're running into right now is, let's call it, how government policy can have unintended consequences. Here's what China's been doing over the past couple of decades. They've decided on the crop side that they were going to have four crops that they were going to call secure commodities. They wanted to be self-sufficient in these commodities. It's almost crucial to their best interest. Those commodities were corn, wheat, rice, and cotton. What they decided to do was incentivize producers to produce as much of those four crops as they possibly could to meet their needs. What they've been doing is they took a page out of our book. They said, okay, how can we get producers to produce those four crops? They said, okay, we're going to set up target prices for those crops. Well, does a target price get you to grow a crop? Depends on where you set the price. Anybody want to guess where they set the price in 2015? $9 a bushel. Can I get you to grow some corn for $9 a bushel? If I can't, we need to talk immediately after this session. Because yeah, did it work for them? It did. This is record production for them in China as far as corn production in 2015. So that part of the policy worked. They produced a lot of corn. What was the unintended consequence? Well, I want you to think about, okay, why did they want all this corn? What were they going to use it for? What would you use it for? Feed, livestock feed. In this case, the pork industry. You know, here I stand in Iowa, work for Iowa State University. Are we big in the hog industry? Yes and no. Yes, we're big in the U.S., but when we compare the U.S. market and pork to China, we are small. The Chinese hog industry is roughly six times the size of the U.S. hog industry. They need a lot of feed. That's why they wanted all this corn. What was the problem with this corn? Well, the problem with this corn that they had just grown is that corn costs $9 a bushel now. Think back to 2015. What were your corn prices here? 3 to 3.5, right? Because we produced a heck of a lot of corn back in 2015. In fact, the world did. That was record production at the time. So that Chinese hog industry was sitting there going, okay, I could feed this domestic $9 corn, or I could go out on the world market, buy that corn from the US or Brazil or Argentina, and I'm only gonna pay $3, $3.5 for it. Well, how much does it cost me to ship that corn from the US over to China? Maybe $3. So now I'm talking $6.5 corn. Which would you rather feed, $9 corn or $6 corn? Well, $6 corn, what did they feed? $6 corn, where did the $9 corn go? Well, it's still sitting there in storage. In fact, as you look at the world situation today in corn, roughly half the world in storage sits in China. And right now they're trying to figure out how to get out from underneath those piles, because they recognize what went into the storage unit as number two yellow corn might be coming out as number four mixed grain. They're losing value. How do you capture that? Well, in order to get out from underneath those piles, they're on a multi-step process to change how they approach corn. Step one, started in 2016, reduce the target price for corn. What's that do there? Drops that production. Step two, take everything that competes with the corn in storage right now and make it cost more. Case in point, our latest trade dispute with China has to do with the tariff that they've slapped on distillers' grains. Why did they put that tariff on? To increase the cost of that so farmers would turn back and use this corn. Now, short run, that's going to hurt us a little bit in the distillers' grains market. But I'm going to argue long run, it helps. Because once they burn through those corn piles, they won't have the production anymore. They'll have moved the acres somewhere else. And that opens up that feed market to more trade. And so in the long run, I'm looking here and I'm seeing dynamics that suggest we'll continue to see trade markets open up. Now, in the case of China, if they're growing less corn, what are they going to grow more of? What would you grow more of? Soybeans. Do I worry about that? No. Here's why. And I hate to tell you this, but pop quiz time, I'm going to make you do a little math. All right, as you look up here at this chart, this is the world soybean table. I'm going to tell you right off the bat, similar story here. Record production in the last 2 years. We are a big dominant player in production. Here's China. China produces about 12 million tons of soybeans each and every year. All right, so about 10% of what we produce. But I want you to think about how much they buy from us and to see just, am I worried about them producing more? Okay, you look at us. We produce 117 million tons last year. We're going to add acreage this year. Let's say 120 million tons this year. How much of that crop do we export? This is testing your short-term memory now. Half. So now I'm talking about 60 million tons that we produced get shipped to other markets. Anybody want to guess out of that 60 million tons, how many of them go to China? 60%. All right, 60% of 60 is, test mathematical skills here, 36 million tons. How much do they produce again? 12. We ship them three times more than they produce right now. Even if they were to double production, they're still going to buy from us. And are we the only market that they buy from? No, I want you to look at Brazil and Argentina here. And they roughly buy about the same amount of crop from them as well. Their demand for soybean is incredible. It's being driven by, I'm going to argue it's a three-pronged issue when you're looking at China and soybeans here. What do they need the beans for? Well, they need the meal to feed those hogs. But I'm going to argue they need oil as well. Vegetable oil, big part of the Asian diet. But you notice they don't buy meal and oil, they buy beans. Why do they want the beans? I'm going to argue employment opportunities. If you think about it, we bring those beans in, what do you need to do to them? You got to crush them. So they have crushing facilities. That's keeping people employed. And so as we look here, that's been incredible. And when I show you the export numbers, you'll see just how big that demand is for us and how I'm watching that. Because as you look over the past couple of years, here's been the, if you will, the storyline. And I'm showing you here, in this case, these are crop margins. 2015 is the first half of this graph. 2016 is the second half. Green line here, that's soybeans, the sort of maize line there, that's corn. What we've experienced is basically this. You can divide the year up into quarters. First quarter, January through March, prices tend to remain fairly flat as we deal with record production and piles of corn and soybeans remaining in storage throughout the countryside. As we get into April, May, June, and I'll key off 2016 here, that's when you see the rally. And I would argue it's a traditional seasonal rally. We get out there in April, May, June, we see those piles starting to disappear because of the demand. We get the crop planted, but we get worried about, will weather allow us to produce another great crop? You put that combination together, that creates that classic weather rally that we get for April, May, June. We ride that basically to almost the 4th of July. 4th of July comes, we go out, we shoot off our fireworks, we look at our crops, and we turn around and we say, you know what? It's looking like a pretty good year this year. And enough people say it, Chicago hears it, and how Chicago react. Prices drop because we see that record crop, and then we try to recover for the last half of the year. We've done that basically the last 2 years in a row, and I'm going to argue we have the potential to do it all over again here in 2017. Probably the only difference, I would argue, is that we started that rally earlier this year, and that's what those crop insurance prices told me. Think about it. We just produced the biggest crops we've had in this country just this last fall. And yet you're staring at better insurance prices today. We've already baked in some of this rally. That's why you've already been seeing some prices on the board that should have been looking highly attractive to you. Now, my concerns going forward is this type of rally needs two pieces going forward. One, I need demand to keep building like it has over the past couple of years. And that means especially I need trade. But second piece, I need something that concern us a little bit on the supply side. Do I have that right now? Maybe. Anybody looked at this map recently? So you look at the drought monitor today. What I'm keying on here is this dry spot that's hovering down here just south of us. It's not that we need a drought to occur. Think back to 2016. And again, let me take you back to those prices. Did we need severely bad weather to give us that rally? No, all we needed was the rumor that it could happen. The thought that, oh, it's looking a little dry out there. And just that rumor added to the fuel to let prices go higher. You have that same fuel sitting out here right now. Because as I look at southern Illinois, in my home state of Missouri, and down here, that drying out, if it sticks around, it will be an issue that the markets will key on. That could slow supplies down a little bit, and if demand remains strong, you've got the same recipe that we had last year to create that seasonal price rally. It's there. So I've got the thought that supplies could slow down. I also need demand, though, to hang up there. And I'm going to argue it is, because when I'm looking at everywhere I'm looking at on our demand markets, I see the potential for growth. I'll start off with the feed market. when I'm looking at the livestock industries here in the U.S., what we've got right now is a situation where I'm going to argue hogs are profitable right now. Look like they will be for them about the next 6 months. Then I get a little lull in here for a while, but then I look out here to 2018 and I see some profitability again. Now, whenever a hog producer sees a profitable hog, what do they want to do? Yeah, I want to raise more hogs, don't I? Or expand. Are we expanding in the hog industry here in Iowa? Yeah, we are. We have been for the past 16, 18 months. This graph tells me that will continue. What's driving the expansion here? Why are we seeing some profitable prices here? I want you to think about that one for a second, because I want to show you, here's the cattle picture. Do you notice that here's something eerily similar? Whether, it doesn't matter where I'm looking in the livestock industry right now, I'm seeing this pattern. Whereas the front half of 17 is showing some profitability for the hog industry, we dive back down for a little bit, but then 2018, I start to see it again. What's driving this is trade. When you look at the meat markets right now, what is happening is that we are seeing international demand, and it doesn't matter for what product you look at here, they're all growing. We're seeing more international demand for meat. That's been going on for the past year, and as USDA projects going forward for this year, it continues. Now, what's happening here, and it seems to be related to an old rule of thumb that I learned about 20 years ago. I was talking to a bunch of food economists back at that time, and they said, when you're watching the developing world, the key thing to look at is how much do people spend on food per day? Because there's a change in the diet that happens when you reach a $2 mark. So if you're spending $2 or less on food per day, your main protein source comes from plants. I want you to think beans. Once you start to spend more than $2 a day, you transfer from the beans to meat. What's happening right now in Southeast Asia is we've got a lot of people crossing that $2 threshold. And what that means is I'm seeing expansion on the livestock industries because the rest of the world wants more meat. That's what's pulling it out of the U.S. That's what's creating higher prices for the livestock industry and improving profitability there. So I'm seeing growth there. In fact, when you look at the meat sector, what I'm looking at is a record 100 billion pounds of meat will be produced this year in the U.S. with on total over 15% of it being shipped to other markets. That's what's, if you will, creating a great big push across all of agriculture. Because it's not just do they want to buy U.S. meat. Let's think about those other countries. Do they want to produce more meat or just buy ours? They'd like to produce their own, wouldn't they? In order to produce their own, what do they need? Feed. Where are they going to get that? More than likely from us. We are the world's largest feed provider. There is. We produce a third of the world's corn, a third of the world's soybeans. We're the feed market for everybody. And that's why I'm seeing growth on the livestock side, meaning feed demand's growing here in the U.S., I'm also seeing export growth. In fact, you look at this year compared to last year. In this case, I want you to look at the green line versus the red line. What you're going to notice here is that we started off the year about 300 million bushels ahead in our export demand on the corn side. Before we even harvested a bushel of corn, we had sold 600 million bushels to the rest of the world. And now, as I stand before you today, that gap's grown to about 600 million bushels. We've seen a sizable surge in demand for corn. Why do they want that corn? They're feeding it to something. And more than likely, it's their livestock industry because they're trying to produce more meat because they're seeing the same pressures we are on the meat side. Now, is this all related to that? I'm going to argue no, it's not. As you look at this graph too, you'll notice actually, once we got past Election Day, that gap seemed to widen. Wonder why that happened. Well, in this case, I'm going to call it the Trump effect. Because as we talked about trade throughout this election, did you ever hear trade in a positive light? Probably not. But when you look at agriculture, I think we've got to talk about it. Because in this case, what I'm showing you here is sort of the same idea. I'm showing you the growth in this year's corn markets as we look internationally. We're up about 600 million bushels, 50% growth. These countries down here I've got listed, though, those are our top six export markets. When you look at them, they're all over the country, or all over the world. You know, I've got Latin America in here, I've got Southeast Asia, I've even got South America in here. Do those countries have anything in common? Well, the only thing they actually really have in common is that they all have trade agreements with the U.S. All right, how many of those six countries are worried it's their trade agreement that gets renegotiated? All six. And if you were worried about trade relations changing, and you were an importer in one of these countries, what would you be doing right now? Buying and stockpiling. Have we seen that? I take you back here. The gap was 300 million bushels at election day, it's 600 million bushels now. Yes, if you will, the trade uncertainty has actually helped boost our exports here over the near term. Now, do I worry about the impacts over the long term? I do. Case in point, who's number one on my list here? Mexico. Are our trade relations strained right now? Yeah. Now, with Mexico, we've been told we're going to build a wall. I only ask for one thing with that wall. I want a drive-through window in it. Because when you look at Mexico, they're 25% of our export market. I mentioned earlier that, you know, when you look at China and Canada, they're worth $20 billion to us in agriculture. Mexico's worth $17 billion worth of stuff. They are our number three ag trade partner and number one in corn. They are a crucial market for us. Now, Mexico has countered some of the rhetoric up here with some rhetoric on their own. They've said, we'll buy from somebody else. Is that a credible threat? The answer is yes and no. Can they buy corn from other places and find enough to meet their needs? Yes. Will it cost them more? Yes. Case in point, I want you to think, where would you think they would go to buy more corn? Brazil, Argentina, South America. Okay, I want you to look at my list behind me again. There are two countries on our top six that are from South America, Colombia and Peru. Wouldn't you figure they would be buying from Brazil and Argentina if it was cheaper for them? Yet instead, they're buying from us. What does that tell you about the economics of getting corn from Brazil and Argentina up into Latin America? They got freight problems. It's going to cost them more. In fact, I'm going to tell you right now, if Mexico were to carry forward on that import ban on U.S. corn, what you would see is both countries get hurt fairly hard. You're going to look at corn prices here, drop by, I'm going to guess, at least 50 cents a bushel. Because it will take us a while to figure out how to get that corn moved somewhere else. But it's also going to cost Mexico probably, I'm going to argue, 30 to 50 cents a bushel more to get that corn. When we talk about trade and trade disputes, you often hear it referred to as a trade war. It's actually a pretty good description, I think. Because when you think about war, the idea is it's that both countries get hurt. That's what will happen here when we have a trade dispute or war. Both sides will definitely get hurt. Now, why am I still sort of optimistic here? Well, I'm going to argue because when I look at what the Trump administration is doing, they're putting the people in place in agriculture that I'm going to argue know and understand this trade and can help hopefully renegotiate at least deals that are just as good as what we have right now and hopefully improve upon them. As I look at Sonny Perdue, the pick for the Secretary of Agriculture, he has been one that has been more aggressive for agricultural trade. He comes from Georgia, where they grow a lot of cotton. And if there's one crop that is even more export reliant than soybeans, it's cotton. We export 70% of it. So he knows, he understands that helps drive this picture. And I want you to think about soybeans. How much of this crop do we export again? Half. And where's most of it go? China. And look at this. This is just the growth in their demand this year. 275 million bushels. Just the growth in their demand this year. Or to put that another way, that is basically 60% of Iowa's entire soybean crop this past fall. Just the change in their demand. Here again, when I look, key appointment from the Trump administration. Who was it? Our governor, Branstad. Why is this a big deal here? Because when you're dealing with China, again, you're dealing with our biggest agricultural trading partner. You're dealing with somebody that we've had trade disputes with almost every time we turn around, yet we put somebody in place who's able to talk with them, understands agriculture, has a relationship with the president of China. So I'm seeing, at least on the ag side, people being put in place to help maintain these trade flows. And hopefully all the rhetoric is just that. Rhetoric. So far, it hasn't hurt our markets. And so I've got feed demand building. I've got export demand building. I've only got one other big source of demand left, and which way is it moving? Up as well. When you're looking at the biofuel side, is there uncertainty here? Yes. But when you're looking at the growth thus far, 2017 started off at a record pace. We haven't had a time where we've used more corn to create fuel than right now. And when I look here, we continue to find ways to get ethanol out in front of U.S. consumers, and they're buying more and more of it. But even here, I want you to think, we actually produce more ethanol than we need. What happens to the excess? We export here as well. We've went from being the world's largest importer of ethanol to the world's largest exporter of ethanol. We sell to Canada, we sell to Mexico, we sell to Brazil, we sell to China. Actually, China is one of my favorites because we're not actually allowed to ship them ethanol. But we can sell them all the industrial alcohol we want. Anybody know the difference between the two? There isn't any. It's just how we label it. They're actually our number four export market for ethanol. My favorite, though, is number nine on the export list. The United Arab Emirates. Where's that? The Middle East. Hang on, you're telling me we're shipping fuel back into the Middle East? Yes, I am. Why do they want biofuel? Why did we get into biofuel? Clean up our air. They got a smog problem. What's the most cost-effective way to deal with that? Biofuels. In fact, when you look, what I'm going to argue is the ethanol industry has evolved over the past few decades. And that evolution now helps them compete in the fuel market. When I moved up here to Iowa in 1991, you'd go to that ethanol plant that was built back there in the 90s, and you were talking about an ethanol plant that could take that bushel of corn and maybe get 2.5 gallons of ethanol out of it. That was about the standard. And, you know, the idea of ethanol technology has been around a long, long time. I grew up in southwest Missouri. I come from a long line of Baptist preachers, used car salesmen, and moonshiners. So if there's one thing my family has known for a long, long time, it's how to take grain and get alcohol out of it. Just for a slightly different reason, but the process was the same. When you look today, our modern ethanol plants, now take that bushel of corn, they're getting 2.9 to 3 gallons per bushel. They've squeezed the efficiency. What that has done is that's made them cost competitive in the fuel market. And so while oil prices have went up to $100 a barrel, down to 30, and now we're floating in the 50s, ethanol has found a way to compete. And it's competing not only here in the U.S., but worldwide. So you've got growth in feed, you've got growth in exports, you've got growth in fuels. You put all that together, what you get is a demand picture that wants to take prices higher. And when you look at what the markets were doing, what are the markets showing? When I look out there, this green bar here represents what the markets were at close of day yesterday. And the further out I look on the corn side, what do I see? A higher price. Again, this market wants to reflect that growing demand. All it needs is the rumor that supplies will slow down a little bit to let this demand catch up. So as you look at, in this case, the crop that's in the bin, now the futures market would say that's going to be worth, by the time it's all said and done, $3.50 a bushel, nationwide average. Most cases here in Iowa, well, we're probably sitting in the $3.20 range when I look at cash prices. Main reason being, basis is a little wider. Well, basis is wider, why? Well, we've got all those piles of corn around still. Until we work through those piles, basis can improve. But as we get deeper into spring, I do expect to see that improvement. As I look out for the crop you're about to plant, the market's been pricing that between $3.80 and $4 for the past month and a half. And in fact, for a while there, December 2017 corn futures were up there around $4, weren't they? $4 in February, that's a pretty good price, especially since we've worked our cost structure down. When I look at what Iowa State says for production cost, I'm looking at an average for Iowa of around $3.60 to $3.65 a bushel. So with $3.85 on the board, this is telling me I'm looking right now at the possibility of some profits today within the market. And as I look out to 2018, this picture continues to get better. Now, if there's a weak spot I see in the markets, it's probably soybeans, and that's mainly because when you think about it, everybody this fall and winter has been talking about how we're going to plant more soybeans. Almost every time I turn around, there's news stories saying we're going to see 88, 89 million acres of soybeans planted. And the market's been preparing for that. That's why you see this down step here as we look for the 17 crop year. But what I want you to key on are the big black numbers. And again, I want you to think back. Where were you at this time last year? What was your cash soybean price? You were staring at something in the eights. Today, we're staring at something in the nines. This market is already reflecting that that demand has been building up and we can probably handle the additional acreage. And right now, we're offering a better price today than you've seen over the past year. And so when I'm looking at returns to the 2017-2018 crop, right now they're showing up at profitable levels, which is something I have not got to talk about for the last 3 years. In fact, I went back and looked at my presentations from last year about this time. This same graph, we would have been down in here. We're fully $100 better today per acre than we were a year ago. We can get caught up in being worried about these big supplies. I want you to think about the demand side as well. And remember, as you're looking at managing through these, and these are still challenging times, what we're doing is we're rebalancing. So this is my lifetime in the corn market. The blue line, average price for a bushel of Iowa corn. The red line, the average cost to produce it. In the last few years, yeah, we've seen some negative returns. But have we been in a situation like this before? Yeah, I would argue over and over again. When you look back here in the 90s, in the 80s, in the 70s, almost every decade, we'll have a stretch like this for 3, 4, 5, 6 years. But after every trough, what is there? There's a rise. And that rise is typically driven when supplies slow down a bit and demand is allowed to catch back up. And that's what seems to be happening today. And that's when I look at 2017, these lines look like they're trying to cross again. It's a game we've been through before. we'll go through again. Agriculture has cycles for a reason. When you look at these big cycles here, the biggest reason why, and you can think about it just within this last 10 years, when you've got profits in this industry, like we had from 2007 to 2013, what does that make us want to do? Produce more crop. Have we done that the past few years? Yeah, four record corn crops in a row, three record soybean crops in a row. What happens to these two lines when you do that? Blue goes down, red goes up, profits go away. That's what we've done. Now we're looking on the flip side. As margins get tighter, people start to look at other alternatives. Supply slowed down, demand ratchets up, and the two lines begin to turn and cross. Like I say, we've been down this road before. It's not that we haven't seen this. Yep, so that's true, and I've heard that a lot. He said the best cure for low prices is low prices. It creates demand, but it also changes what people are going to plant. Now, in this case, I'm going to argue the reason this downturn lasted as long as it did is because typically it's not only just creating that demand, but it's talking about how do you limit supplies. And I want to take you back to a map, so bear with me. The drought monitor map will work. I want you to think about what has happened in places in the country that don't traditionally grow corn and soybeans. Places like the Great Plains, like the Southeast. What have they been doing over the past few years? They've been moving into corn and soybeans. Why have they been moving in? Higher prices, better returns. Let's face it, has the wheat market been all that attractive? The cotton market been all that attractive? No, it's hard to find a market in agriculture that's looked really attractive over the past few years. In fact, I've got this one joke. I say I look across the entire cash crops complex. The problem is I can only find one profitable crop. And the challenge with that crop is it's only legal in 8 states. That has been a challenge, finding profitability. What has been happening in the last few years is that other areas of the country, they couldn't find the profitability in their traditional crops, so they moved to corn and soybeans. The problem is, as they moved into corn and soybeans, how well did that work for them? Well, in the case of production, it worked out fairly well. If I'm looking at places like the Great Plains here, you look at their yields for 2016, you're looking at record corn and soybean yields. Did the move play out for them? Yeah, about as well as it could have, I would argue. That's why we've had a hard time turning these markets around, because we've been able to create those record supplies year after year after year, meaning that acreage out here in the Great Plains or down here in the Southeast hasn't had to move out yet. And that's still the challenge today as I look at 2017. They're not moving out, they're still moving in, actually. How are we getting to 88 million acres of soybeans? Means a lot of land that used to go to wheat is now going to beans. That's going to be our challenge here. And that's why when I look at prices, what I do worry about is a replay of 2016. That we will get this rally based upon demand, but if we overproduce for that demand, we can do this all over again, where we can watch those prices disappear very quickly. All right, I've rattled on for quite some time. You all haven't stopped me nearly enough. What questions, comments, or tomatoes do you have for me? Shoot, sir. So let me take on the first question. I'll take them on in order. So the first question, soybeans. Why don't we export more as meal and oil, keep the crushing jobs here? Well, I do want you to look at crush here. The half we don't export, what do we do with it? We crush it. So we do a lot of crushing. We're actually a big exporter on all sides. What we don't do, or to put it another way, is that we don't try to influence how we export the product. And what I mean by that is, you look at a country like Argentina. What they did was they set up differential taxes for soybeans based upon how you export the product. The taxes were higher if you exported the beans alone, lower if you exported the meal or the oil, trying to keep those crushing jobs in country. Well, that works well as long as somebody's not out there competing against you in that market to drive prices lower. And so what Argentina's run into is sometimes that they can't move the product that they want to move. Because in the case of the U.S., we don't care. If you want to buy the beans directly, we'll sell you the beans directly. You want meal and oil, we'll provide you meal and oil. We do both really well. We don't try to pick and choose that winner there. Give the buyer what he wants. I'm reminded, my parents ran a little mom and pop processing plant for 30 years. And I'm reminded of the rule that my dad taught me when he would leave me down there when I was 13 to run the shop for a while. I'd sell customers hamburger, lunch meats, things such as that. He goes, Chad, you got two rules to live by when you're in this store. Rule number one, the customer is always right. Because that's who we sell to. That's what keeps this business running. They want something and we can do it, we need to do it for them. As long as we can do it cost effectively. Yep, sell them a white pickup. Rule number two, never forget rule number one. That customer's key here. So yeah, we'll sell them what they want. And so when I look, that's why when you look here, yeah, we'll crush a lot. We use a lot of that meal, but we sell a lot as well. We're a big exporter in soybean meal and soybean oil. But we'll sell the customer what they want. Now, when you're looking at the drought for your question two, the idea is you were saying, you know, you didn't tend to make profits when you're betting on a drought. Well, I'm not asking you to bet on a drought. In fact, if anything, I'm going to say that I'm looking at these markets the same way you are, looking for price protection. And I take you back to this graph. Why I'm bringing up the drought monitor is that all I need is the weather scare to create this price run-up. If I'm getting this price run-up, though, I want to use it for price protection. I want to grab that price while it's in this rally, while it's just, if you will, the rumor stage of problems, that I know I can put in a good price, some price floors, pre-harvest marketing. But am I betting on the drought? No. Because if I were betting on the drought, what would I be doing? I wouldn't be doing anything because I'd be betting prices are going to go higher all the way through harvest. I'm saying, no, don't do that. Take advantage of these opportunities here. And I'm reminded of another rule I was taught by another man. My predecessor in this job, Bob Wisner. As he was walking out the door and I was walking in, he said, Chad, don't forget this one fact. It's hard to lose money making a profit. So if I can get a profit on the board in April, I should take a little bit of it. If I got a profit on the board today, I should take a little of it. In fact, another thing as we looked at marketing is that the more, if you will, the more often you market in little pieces, the better off you tend to do. In fact, I've done this study with my students. What we've done is we've taken the last 40 years worth of crop pricing data, and we set up basically a competition versus the average price that farmers receive in the country. We compare that to if a marketer had just went out, looked at taking 70% of their expected crop, marketing it in 10% chunks, pre-harvest, January, February, March, April, May, June, July, 15th of each month. Didn't care what prices were. We just, each time, 10%, bam, 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 bam. Analyzed that for 40 years. Compared that to what the average farmer gets, we find that that averaging technique is worth about a dime a bushel more. Think about that, a dime a bushel more over 40 years. A dime doesn't sound like much, but over 40 years and the number of bushels, it pays for the farm. So yeah, I look at opportunities like this as times to grab that dime. You know, oftentimes when you see a rally like this, people will go, and I'll ask them, I'm like, are you marketing any? And half the time the answer is no. And I'm like, well, okay, futures at that time, you saw futures at 425. And I said, what are you waiting for? And the answer almost always was 450. Did 450 come? No. Yeah, because if it did, they'd wait till 5. You're right. Oftentimes we let emotion overwhelm our marketing sense. In fact, that's why we spend a lot of time talking about marketing plans and things. Things that force us to recognize that when you see a good price, a profitable price, take advantage of it. I've been at this game for 20-some years. I study the markets all the time. Could I tell you when that price top is going to be in there? No, if I could, I wouldn't be in front of you today. If I knew when that was going to happen, I would be in Aruba with a drink in my hand. Instead, I am here. And to tell you how hard it is to time that thing. Even your best market analyst is wrong nearly half the time. What we rely upon are rules of thumb that say, you know, when you see that profitable price, grab it. Mark it in chunks. These are rules that have proven themselves time and time again. When you look at the offerings Landis has for you, they've designed those contracts to try to take advantage of some of the patterns that we see over time. A lot of those that are based upon some sort of average pricing are based upon these seasonal patterns that we see. That's why we make those offerings to you, to try to, if you will, help farmers market their grain profitably. Because in the end, what we need to create here is a win-win situation. You as producers need to be profitable to stay on the farm, to stay in business. The cooperatives, they need to make a little money too to stay in business. And so it's best if both can share on that. That's why they're offering you programs like this, to try to help you take advantage of what the markets will give you. So the question here is about the Trump administration. Are they putting the right people in place in different areas?
I understand Branstad and all that stuff. I think it's the right man in the right place at the right time.
Yep.
But he can't do it himself.
Well, that's the deal. He can't do it himself. And I think when you look here, the thing that you'll have to recognize with the administration, he's going to be putting people in place to help guide him on all sorts of various pieces here. Ag is only one piece of the trade picture. As you mentioned, manufacturing is another. Innovation and sort of, for lack of a better term, our science, our research, our development, you know, patents, that type of thing. So he has to have a multifaceted team. When you look at any sort of trade agreement, the idea is it takes years to negotiate and hundreds of people working on each side, if not thousands. And so when I look at, like I say, when I look at the Trump administration on the ag side, the people he's putting in place to talk about ag trade, yes, they understand that game. The Trump administration is also picking those on the manufacturing side that understand what's going on there. When you're looking at trade, it's always a game of, again, trade. What are you willing to, if you will, give up in order to gain what you want? What we have been successful on when I look at agricultural trade is we've been able to open up key markets for us, but we've had to give stuff up as well. But oftentimes, what we've given up is what we, if you will, what we are the weakest at. What trade tends to do is it tends to expose who can be the most competitive on the global sphere. Now, when you look at agriculture, I'm going to take you back here to the world tables. When you look at soybeans or corn, you'll notice we are the dominant player. Soybeans, we produce a third of the world's crop. Corn, we produce a third of the world's crop. From a crop and livestock agriculture perspective, the U.S. is a dominant player because we are a high volume, low cost producer, which means we are built to trade. Exports will flow out. We're not that way in every market. And in fact, manufacturing was one where we're not that high volume, low cost. We were high volume, high cost. What's the, if you will, the disadvantage that we had on the manufacturing side? Labor. We have high labor costs. And so it made sense that manufacturing was probably going to be an area we were going to, if you will, lose in the trade pattern. Now, the question for the Trump administration is, can they balance this? And I would argue they're trying to put a team in that hopefully can. Like I say, the ag guys are going to try to protect what we've been able to grow and do thus far, where the manufacturing advisors are going to try to figure out, okay, are there ways to slow the more negative impacts of trade? in those sectors. How well will that work? Well, proof's going to be in the pudding. I can't tell you right now. But I can say, at least from my perspective on the ag side, we are getting the right people in place. And how does it go forward from here? When I look, what I'm keying on, especially as I look at the corn market, I'm watching a place like Japan. They're our number two market there. They have been highly concerned about what this trade renegotiation means, but they've also been relatively quiet because they've talked to the administration a couple of times. My sense is that they've heard what they wanted to hear. They heard that, no, we're going to try to maintain that flow. We're going to try to, you know, be a good partner with you. And so I think we are seeing, after a rocky start, our ducks are getting back in a row. We are getting the team in place that we need. But yeah, trade is crucial for me here.
Just so the commodities don't get mixed up with all this other stuff.
Sure. And that's the deal. When we get to the commodities, and I'll especially pick on, you know, when you look at China, the idea is that the ding, 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 ding. When they start talking about hitting this market, that's when you know China is serious about this, and so is the U.S. Because that is a major ag trade component for us both. All right, I do want to thank you all for your time, for your patience listening for me here today. What I hope you find as you go through 2017 is, if you will, that I'm partially right. And usually I say, may I be completely wrong when I'm Dr. Doom. But since I've got a more optimistic story here, since I do see better prices, what I hope you find is that we get into 2016, we start to see this price rally like we did in 2016, but you're able to hold on to much more of it than we have been over the past couple of years. That you find 2017 to be a happy, healthy, prosperous, and profitable year. But just in case I was completely right, don't say you weren't warned, folks. Thank you all very much, and have a great rest of your day.